So, last time I was working on a farming game for my wife, and I wanted to make it open source, and I had a bunch of assets that I needed to replace to make it open source friendly. And the big one was the Node Canvas for creating dialogue. And that's what I've been doing for the past 4 months. Turns out making your own dialogue system and then deciding to make it a full, proper, generalized scripting language is a whole thing. So, I've recorded this several times, and they're all long and rambly. Let's get into this. So first up, a dialogue example. So over here we can choose from some preset scripts and then who to run it with. Shopkeep. Let's just get into it. Run. Welcome player. How are you going? There we go. There's a little wait there and an emotion change. Say, I'm good, thank you. Excellent. Glad to hear it. We can either say goodbye or ask a question. What do you want to know? Who are you? And enough questions. So if we go over here and scroll down to the question section, you can see there's some variables that have been set up and some conditionals of choices that will show if those variables are true. And then we also have our typo here. So if we fix that, run this again. Hello, player. I'm still good. Question. Enough questions. So if we choose the one option of who are you, we can see down here, who am I? It will also set one of the variables to true. So who are you? Just a person. Anyway, now we have the next thing that shows up. Where is this? This is a text box. Great. What is this? This ER shop for talking about dialogue. More typos. So that's down here. So we can fix that as well. But we don't need to rerun it. There we go. So very simple. Enough questions. There we go. It comes back to I'm good, thank you, which was the choice we made before. And we can say goodbye. We can also rerun it with a different person, the wizard, who is purple and has the name wizard. And then we can also change the script to the wizard script, who is much more serious. You have. How do you know I was coming? You can see up the top here, there's also a wait. And we have extra things. We have chance. Are you ready for some chance? Yeah, we can see we've got some random things that can happen somewhere in here. Where's the chance? Here is the chance. So here we see we can jump to a random choice within this little function here. We have choice one, it's happy, random choice one, all of this. We have after random choices, so we can sort of have it where within functions using sort of the, even though it's Lisp style, we've got these labels that we can jump around and have it ultimately print out some text. Goodbye, wizard. There we go. That's dialogue. A more visually interesting example is this drawing one. We have it where we can draw boxes in a circle. Boom. Now this looked like it took some time, and that's because per frame we were only running 10 lines of code, and that's 10 compiled lines of code, which one of these things could turn into any number of lines of code potentially. So we've got the circle, but we can make this an ellipse if we change this from to 20 to 50, make the X position much wider, and let's put in some more. And let's run. There we go. Might need to zoom out a bit. Yeah, it looks pretty elliptical as we scroll around. And we can also see that the color breaks somewhere around here because the hue value goes over 100. Actually, it goes over 1. It's probably more the problem. but if we change this to 200 now, because we added in that we show more boxes, now the hue will change slower as it goes around, but then it shouldn't break once it gets to over 100. There we go. And we can also make it run faster. If we do 100 steps of code. Yum. So, yeah. And now that means each frame we've got a little loop and we're going through and it's having to go through and calculate all of this. If we have a semi-native example where we calculate the positions and the color in C-sharp code instead of out here, We can't change how it's positioned or what the color is, how it's calculated, but we can see it runs much faster. If we bring that back down to 10, run it again. We could, you know, up this to 1,000. Color should probably break just the same way, but we can't change that. So I guess that's the trade-off. Scripting language. We can see we're only halfway through. We can pause it. We can kind of still see it happening off into space. Yeah, and then I have a fully native example where basically, it doesn't clear. So even though our native example will draw, but it won't clear things. So we need to go in there, draw.clear. There we go. Now it doesn't make the ground because all it does is draw the thing. And this make ground is coming from another helper script that is loaded in before all these other ones. So it's actually multiple scripts joined together, which is why make ground exists in this scope over here, but the draw doesn't. There we go. Now it looks like the other one. If we come back to here, go to the next example, draw random. So this is something a little bit different. It's using the same draw element example? Function, but here instead we're picking from a random list of box, sphere, or capsule, choosing a random vector from between two objects, a random scale, and then we're also making use of the random color, and again another helper script from somewhere else, and drawing 100 things. But we can bump that up to 1,000. We can bring this down to 0 and see how long does it take. Pretty quick to draw 1,000 things, including having to jump around all this stuff over here. I'm sure Unity loves drawing all these particle effects. We can still change this, you know, we can make this a taller box. 40. Tall box. And we can make the scales much more wacky. We can make it that it's some very wide things. At least in the x-axis. So, yeah. It's a reasonably quick visual example of the scripting language. You probably wouldn't be using it for this, but there you go. That's drawing. So I have done some performance testing over time. Here I went back and reran all the old commits and saw see how well it performed over time. That's clearly an error. Blue one, the top one, is the first runtime, and the second, as I realized, the JIT kind of kicks in more, especially if you run it again, over here. I didn't realize that until a little bit later. But here is the very first version, which was all, well, not first version, the first version of the perf test, which was all the JSON-based, everything was done on the stack, no variables. Then I added variables, and everything got slow. And then I kind of brought it back down again, and then at some point I think I changed to a Lisp version and got rid of the stack entirely. Stopped using the stack directly and just used variables, and I got, whoa, real slow again. And I improved it again. Did something bad there. And this is sort of around where it is here. I think here is where I inlined some more stuff, inlined the function calls and all of that. And when I say inline, I mean I don't mean inline the function, I meant just the function call. I'm not looking at functions that are effectively constants, I'm directly calling the functions if I know what they are. That improved things only a little bit, but anyway. The performance test itself was just looping over something a million times, calling two random numbers functions, and then adding the result and doing that loop. It was a very simple thing, but I wanted to test calling a function, calling a function within the script, calling an external function, which is random, then doing a loop. I also made a website for it. It's very rough. It lives on sort of off my GitHub, which is profile.alanlaurie.me. You know, makes sense for a scripting language webpage. All of this is using the TypeScript port, so this is all running within the browser itself. The TypeScript version you can find on npm. You can run loops in here, get a little loopage going on, change it down to just 5. There we go. We got the performance test. This definitely takes longer in Firefox. Safari, on MacBook and iOS is very impressively fast, I will say. This takes usually like 300, 200 to 300 milliseconds. I've got an example of some of the conditional work I've been doing. Turned into a little dialogue example with a very clunky prompt where I have to put in waits, otherwise you wouldn't be able to see the response. Hello there. Can I have a new name? There you go, and if I click OK and give it an empty name, it goes, alright, I'll come up with a name. How about Fred? There you go, can I have a new name again, please? And I give you a blank. How about Fred? Still Fred? There is a random there. It'd be great if you could give me the other random name. That would be Frederica. There we go. And goodbye. So, you can see the conditional stuff here is if the name length is 0, then we set the name to an inline if. If greater than 0.5, it's Fred or Frederica. So, you can use if statements like expressions, which is really neat. You can use switch cases as well, like expressions. But I don't use that in this example. This text box could probably be bigger. Switch cases is not quite like a regular switch case. It basically just runs all of these conditionals until one is true, and then it runs the code within that conditional, with true being effectively the else. And it's done. And then I've got a very convoluted example for interacting with the browser itself. It basically just chooses a random color, chooses a random theme, and then sets it, and then within the CSS, if the background class is green or the theme is dark, it changes the text color in the background image. Went ahead and made some very basic syntax highlighting for Visual Studio Code. Probably need to update this code example here because I've actually got ink and less than and add are the old operator names, and I was like, I should just use regular operators. I could maybe alias these to both the same thing, but anyway. But this is what the performance example looks like. It's just this little loop here, and it calls rand. And yeah, requirements none. It's just text highlighting. So overall, this has been a good experience. I've learned a lot. I tried to keep this not too long and rambly. I've made several scripts already that were very, very rambly and technical, and I'm like, this is just a blog post. There's nothing visual to show with any of this stuff. How do I show all the different things? I'm not someone who can spend a lot of time visualizing code changes over a 4-month period in an interesting way. That's not me. So the performance overall, I'm pretty happy with. It performs better than NLua and Moonsharp in the use case of you want to run a lot of external calls, but if you're just running a lot of internal scripts, like you're doing a lot of, I don't know, looping and doing CPU intensive, but you're not going out of the VM, NLua and Moonsharp will definitely outperform it, especially NLua. But that's not what this is for. This is for effectively gluing together your external code within some conditions. It's not meant to be all that performant, so yeah. Anyway, did I say the scripting language? It's called Lycithia. Just because I wanted... A friend recommended it because Lycithia is a moon of Jupiter, and like Lua is a celestial body. So is Lycithia, but it's much smaller. And that's kind of what this is. It's a very small scripting language that's designed to just glue together stuff. Anyway, hopefully I'll be back to doing other things one day. And not taking many months to do this one thing. Yeah, anyway, see you in the next one.